Let me thank you in the first place, you, Andrzej, and Alicja, for organizing such a great meeting and for inviting me here. Thank you again. So we will continue with our third session about, we're going to continue talking about national experience. And I would like to invite over here Maria van Heese. She will talk about the implementation of the directive in the Netherlands. So we will start with Netherlands.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for having the opportunity to share with you some experiences in the Netherlands. And also special thanks to our Polish hosts for this wonderful, well-organized and pleasant conference. In my presentation, I will focus on the implementation of the directive in the Netherlands, of course, and the amendments in Dutch law, and also share some experiences with you on the directive. I work at the Cultural Heritage Inspectorate in the Netherlands, which is part of the Ministry of Culture. And the inspectorate is responsible for supervising compliance with European legislation and also the implementation of the 1970 and 1954 conventions of UNESCO in the Netherlands. And we also have supervisory tasks on the preservation of the state collections in the Netherlands, and for objects which are deemed indispensable and irreplaceable for our cultural heritage. And I have other colleagues which are involved in the heritage fields of archaeology and archives. And the decision for appointing the inspector as an authority for the directive was published in the Bulletin of Acts and Decrees on 16 December 2015. For the implementation of the directive, several national laws were changed in the Netherlands, but the amendments did not lead to major changes, and the transposition of the old directive into the new one was already published in June 2015. And it took until the last day to file this up into the system of Brussels, but it was already done in the summer of 2015. The directive has been ratified for the entire Kingdom of the Netherlands. And the most important amendments in Dutch law are in the civil code, with the notion of due diligence when acquiring an object and considering all the circumstances, and the extension of 3 years for the return proceedings. And also in the code of civil procedure, with the definition of a cultural code in the meaning of Article 2 sub 1 of the directive. And as said, the amendments of the new directive did not lead to major changes in Dutch legislation, because the most important changes were already made in 1992 regarding the right of property and the greater protection against unlawful export and sale. As until 1992, we did not have a real law to protect cultural goods from sale and export. And the provision that the competent court shall award the possessor compensation as it deems fair according to the circumstances of the case, provided that it is satisfied that the possessor exercised due care and attention in acquiring an object, that was for Dutch jurisprudence a breakthrough. And when the 1992 amendment judgment to Dutch law came into effect, the most important barriers for becoming a party to the 1970 UNESCO Convention were also taken, and this came into force in 2009 in the Netherlands. So Directive 93/7 was, so to speak, a considerable pioneer in the Netherlands. The legally protected cultural heritage is defined in the Cultural Heritage Preservation Act of 1984, which was also rather late comparing to other countries. And the main goal of this Preservation Act was the prevention of objects and collections which are of special historical and scientific meaning from being lost to our cultural heritage. This act will be merged into a new Cultural Heritage Act, and that shall come into force next July the 1st. Yes. In the new act, all Dutch cultural legislation is combined, including European legislation and the implementation acts of the 1970 and 1954 UNESCO conventions. And regarding European and international legislation, there are no substantive changes from the current legislative practice. The designation of cultural heritage in the Netherlands is a combination of a generic and a specific protection regime. It is the objects which are irreplaceable and indispensable, and the inventories of museums, libraries, and archives, inventories of religious institutions, protected monuments and parts thereof, illicitly excavated objects, and archival materials and elements thereof. And this will be published also, is taken over in the New Heritage Act. And this definition is in accordance with the criteria of a cultural object in the directive, and it also fits within the meanings of Article 36 of the Treaty of the European Union and of Article 20F of the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. And in the Netherlands, also literature and science do fall under the definitions of the Netherlands, which makes it a bit broader and more in line with the definition in 1970 UNESCO Convention. For us, the removal of the annex with the classification of cultural goods into 15 categories is an advantage, because now also cultural goods which do not meet the financial and age thresholds are qualified for a return procedure. And as said before, the directive made the implementation of the 1970 UNESCO Convention in the Netherlands possible. Several aspects, like the periods for starting a return procedure with 30 and 75 years, sanction measures, and safeguarding measures to store objects in a safe place under adequate climatic circumstances and with a proper registration, are tuned to each other. And the notion of due diligence and fair compensations, when all the circumstances of the acquisition were taken into account, as stated in Article 10 of the directive, is in its content the same as Article 6 of the 2009 Implementation Act of the UNESCO Convention. But the 2009 Implementation Act of the UNESCO Convention goes further in the way that from art dealers and auctioneers also registration is required of information from the seller. And as they are professionals, also more responsibility from them is expected on research and provenance. And this is also stated in our Penal Code in Article 437. Directive and the Implementation Act are private law, and sanction measures are in the right of reclamation by a member state or a rightful claimant. Additional sanction measures for theft, fencing, misappropriation, or any other criminal offense are to be found in a penal code. The authorization of export licenses and control by customs and the inspectorate at the outside borders of the EU, and that is in the Netherlands mainly Schiphol Airport and Rotterdam Harbor, offer the possibility to check the importance and legal status of works of art when they cross the borders. In case an object might leave the territory of the Netherlands definitive, and it meets the criteria of indispensable and irreplaceable, and of outstanding magnificence, which is a new criteria in the Heritage Act, an emergency procedure can be started for keeping the object in the Netherlands. So far, this possibility was never used. We have quite a liberal climate in the Netherlands. And customs and the inspectorate work closely together on the basis of an enforcement plan and on risk analysis based on, for example, the ICOM red list and countries in a vulnerable position. For other EU member states, when we see heritage from other member states which are offered for export in an export license, we also refer back to our colleagues in the EU member states to see whether or not it falls under their criteria of protected cultural heritage. And as the directive and the regulation 116/2009 on the export of cultural goods are complementary to each other, an export license can be refused when cultural goods are legally protected and are exported outside the EU without the proper permissions of the national authorities. A reference to this refusal can be found in Article 2 sub 2 of the directive. The unlawful removal of a cultural good outside the territory of a member state is in breach with the rules of the protection of culture of national heritage or with regulation 116/2009. And the legal basis for the required due diligence, as is stated in the recitals and in Article 10 of the directive, might also be found in Box 17 of Council Regulation 1081/2012, for the application of Regulation 116/2009. And Box 17 gives the possibility to mention other characteristics when applying for an export license that might be useful for the identification by customs, like historical antecedents and former owners, and also bibliography. And this extra information might give us, the issuing authorities, more certainty on the identification of cultural goods when it is offered for export. Greater awareness on due diligence and provenance is high on the Dutch agenda and is, for example, discussed with art dealers, umbrella organizations of the art trade, the organization of important fairs like the European Fine Art Fair in Maastricht, and heritage institutions in the Netherlands. Often we receive an export license with a provenance as ex-private collection Germany or France or the UK bought before 1970. And this seems very unsatisfying. What do? How can you be sure? And the notion of provenance as stated in Box 17 shall be taken into a procedure as of next April, to deliver information to the Customs Central Licensing Office and the Cultural Heritage Inspector when applying for a license. And the name of the former owner must be mentioned, as its address and the date of purchase and any significant other characteristics. And for the next meeting of the expert group on the export of cultural goods, which is next April 11, the Netherlands and Belgium have proposed to discuss this item with the EU colleagues to explore the existing practices and procedures on provenance and on how the control is dealt with in the different member states, and to define the national legal basis on which the issuing authorities require to be informed on the provenance of a cultural good before issuing an EU export license. And this might be of help to reach uniform control level by the issuing authorities. Well, of course, the aim of the directive is the material return of a cultural good which has left the territory of a member state unlawfully. Requests from member states are always 100% observed in the Netherlands. We do not have much experience with formal return procedures. There were two formal return procedures under Article 5.2, now Article 6 in the court procedure. And that was a request by the Czech Republic in 2009 for a statue, and a request by Italy in 2002 for the return of an armor. A request for safeguarding archival material originating from an archive in Amsterdam in 2006 under Article 4.1, now Article 5, has been refused by the German authorities. And in another case, an amicable settlement was reached with the UK. The objects could be returned to the Netherlands. In several requests for identification, the Netherlands has assisted and informed the authorities in Belgium, Denmark, France, and the UK, for example. But in all these cases, the criteria of legally protected works of art were not met, nor the date of unlawful removal after 1 January 1993 could be proven. And in the past years, it was sometimes difficult to determine what way would be the best to deal with requests for return, under the directive or under the penal code or maybe mediation procedure. We have this example of a statue of Venus, and it was stolen in 1990 from a Romanian museum. It was given in consignment to a Dutch art dealer at a fair, and there it was discovered as stolen. It was registered into the Interpol database. It took a long time to decide for the Romanian authorities to start a procedure under the directive in Dutch court or under the penal code. And finally, it became the penal code. To make a long story short, the public prosecutor decided to return the object to Romania, and at that point, the holder of the statue formally complained. In the end, the court decided that the Dutch private collector has acted in good faith and was therefore the rightful owner. His objections were that it could not be proven that stolen statue was the same as the one in his possession, as probably more of these statues were made in the second century before Christ. And this reasoning was followed by the judge. He found it a very sad example. Member states do consider the pros and cons of a return procedure. The cost of a legal procedure, as well as costs for transport, storage, and insurance can be high, and for an object of a low financial value, one might choose for another option. And this assessment provides a certain selection and balances the administrative burden of the authority and of the courts. But there is hope, because there are also several examples of returns outside the use and scope of the directive in the Netherlands. And this might be even more than treated under the directive. And one can say that these returns were also stimulated by the ICOM Code of Ethics and by the 1970 UNESCO Convention, because these two instruments made heritage institutions certainly very more aware of the necessity of research and legal status and due diligence. And there is one example I would like to mention here, and it is a very recent example that in the preparations for an exhibition of Sicily and the Sea in the Allard Pierson Museum in Amsterdam, and that museum has a very nice archaeological collection, mainly of Roman and Greek archaeological objects. In the preparation of this exhibition, it was discovered that objects which were acquired in the 1980s by the museum from a private person in Belgium. And it turned out that the objects came from the so-called Capistello wreck, and that was discovered in 1957 near the Lipari Islands. And when this questionable underwater provenance was discovered, it was decided to return the circa 40 objects to the proper Sicilian and Italian authorities after the ending of the exhibition next April 17. So, it is a positive example for return of unlawfully removed cultural heritage before 1 January 1993. And as was stated in the fourth evaluation report of the directive of 30 May 2013, the directive was not much applied by the member states, and there are not much claims for return. With the new directive, the most important bottlenecks are tackled, and a lot is expected from the new IMI system on the exchange of information between the member states. Still, there are difficult issues to deal with, like high legal costs for procedures in court, difficulty of proof of the moment of unlawful removal, and a moment of transfer into the territory of another member state. But the preventive effect of the directive cannot be underestimated, nor its stimulating effect regarding the importance of cultural heritage and the return to its rightful owners, whereby also alternative dispute resolutions might be sought. Thank you for your attention.